molt especialment estar aquí per portar doncs, les veus del doctor Josep Joan Moreso, rector de la nostra universitat, que per raons d'agenda no ha pogut estar aquí amb vosaltres com era el seu desig, atès doncs, la importància que dona als estudis i a aquesta facultat, i em toca doncs, a mi substituir-lo i donar-vos doncs, a tots la benvinguda en el nou curs, els que comenceu per primer cop i els que ja sou d'anys anteriors. A continuació, doncs, té la paraula el doctor Luis Pejenaute, degà de la Facultat de Traducció i Interpretació.
Sí, moltes gràcies. Li agraeixo al vicerector la seva presència aquí amb nosaltres en aquest acte d'avui. Benvolguts companys, benvolguts estudiants, us diré unes paraules molt breument i després passaré a presentar el nostre convidat d'avui. Us saludo a tots i us dono la benvinguda a aquest acte amb què celebrem l'obertura del curs acadèmic. Ens trobem en una etapa sumament exigent per al món universitari. El procés d'harmonització europea representa una oportunitat de canvi profund del sistema universitari català i espanyol. Fer-lo creïble i assolir resultats amb èxit en les múltiples facetes que comporta suposarà un notable esforç que exigeix sumar energies, posar en comú idees i debatre punts de vista molt diversos. Com ja sabeu, l'adaptació dels estudis a l'Espai Europeu d'Educació Superior comporta l'establiment d'un nou paradigma docent centrat en l'estudiant. Comporta també l'adopció d'una nova unitat de valoració de l'activitat acadèmica, el crèdit europeu, i una nova manera d'afrontar l'avaluació de l'aprenentatge. El deganat d'aquesta facultat, de la Facultat de Traducció i Interpretació, ha assumit la responsabilitat de liderar la preparació de noves titulacions que estiguin plenament d'acord amb l'espai europeu, no només pel que respecta als elements estructurals, sinó molt especialment en relació als enfocaments dels processos d'ensenyament i aprenentatge i a l'avaluació dels assoliments de la formació rebuda. Volem crear titulacions que responguin veritablement a les necessitats sociolaborals del nostre entorn, tenint en compte la diversitat d'ocupacions professionals en què s'ubiquen els nostres graduats. Avui mateix, com a president de la Comissió de Programació d'Estudis de l'Àmbit de Traducció i Lingüística, he atès la sol·licitud del vicerrector de Docència i li he fet arribar la proposta que aquesta comissió ha consensuat de manera unànime. Articulant-se a partir dels continguts de l'actual llicenciatura de Traducció, Interpretació i de Lingüística, tenim la intenció de cobrir tot l'espai de formació en l'àmbit de la mediació lingüística i les llengües aplicades. Evidentment, la preparació dels nous plans d'estudi serà responsabilitat d'una comissió que encara no està constituïda, que tindrà l'obligació de consultar les diferents parts implicades en la vida universitària amb la finalitat d'aconseguir el major consens possible i d'aprofitar al màxim la llibertat que ens atorga ara el Ministeri d'Educació amb la nova normativa prevista. Vull també, per descomptat, aprofitar per presentar-vos al conferenciat d'avui, el doctor Michael Cronin, que és, sense cap mena de dubte, una de les personalitats més destacades en el panorama actual de la disciplina dels estudis de traducció i interpretació, dels estudis de traducció. El doctor Michael Cronin és professor a la Dublin City University, on dirigeix el Center for Translation and Textual Studies. La seva recerca s'ha centrat en la història de la traducció a Irlanda, en la relació entre traducció i viatges i en els efectes que ha tingut la globalització en el món de la traducció. Si alguna cosa caracteritza a Michael Cronin és el fet de saber-se moure amb la mateixa capacitat tant a l'hora de rastrejar la pràctica de la traducció al seu país al llarg del temps com a l'hora d'estudiar l'impacte dels darrers avanços tecnològics en la manera de practicar i de concebre la traducció. Actualment està preparant un llibre on estudia la presència de la traducció en el món del cinema. És l'autor d'un bon nombre de llibres com Translating Ireland, Translation Languages Identities del 96, Across the Lines, Travel Language and Translation del 2000, Translation and Globalization del 2003, Time Cracks, Scenes from the Irish Everyday 2003, i ha editat llibres com Tourism in Ireland, A Critical Analysis, Antologia de Novel·la Irlandès, Units in Diversity, Current Trends in Translation Studies, etc. etc. Un bon nombre de publicacions. I ja sense més preàmbuls ja li dono la paraula.
Bé, gràcies, doctor Pejenaute. I a continuació doncs, té la paraula el professor Michael Cronin per fer la seva dissertació. I baixem a baix perquè farà una pel·lícula i així la podrem veure.
the very first thing I would like to say is muchas gracias to the University of Pompeu Fabra for inviting me. I'd like particularly to thank the Vice Rector, he's an extremely busy man, and I'm very flattered and gratified you should attend this lecture. A special word of thanks to Professor Genalte, who I've met on a number of occasions, whose work I admire, and I'm particularly grateful to him for organizing this visit here to Barcelona. You may have noticed something. This jacket is a very, very heavy jacket. In Professor Pajanalte's office, there's a very, very large, heavy overcoat. So if from time to time I look a bit wobbly, it's just I'm trying to adjust from 5 degrees Celsius to 25 degrees Celsius. So I can explain it away in that way. What I want to do in this lecture this afternoon is basically to look at the way in which translation studies has changed, the kinds of things that we're looking at now in translation studies. And in particular, the way in which translation and translators are represented in one of the most powerful media, if you like, of influence in the contemporary world, which is cinema in its various forms. In other words, there's been a great deal of work in translation studies on what you might call the techniques of translation as they relate to cinema, so that would be dubbing, subtitling, and so on. But less work has been done on how translators and translation are represented on the screen. In other words, how are translation and translators presented to audiences of mainstream cinema? Because if we go back even as far as the silent cinema, if we go to Laurel and Hardy, the Marx Brothers, if we fast forward to the Star Wars trilogies, the original and the prequel, what we find is a long history of cinema's engagement with the theme and topic of translation. But before I look at this in some detail, I want to kind of, if you like, sketch out a context for us, first of all. One of the things that's been said about translation studies is that for many years, what translation studies basically looked at, and this when it was driven primarily by a linguistics paradigm, was very often the question of text. What happened to texts when they went from one language to another? What were the transformations in language? And subsequently, what were the transformation in text types, and so on. Then there's what we sometimes refer to as the cultural turn in translation studies, when people were looking more and more at the kind of socio-political and historical background to the work of translators and to the kinds of historical and cultural contexts into which texts were translated. More recently, one could argue that what has been a major focus of interest in translation studies, so moving from texts to cultures, to the question of what is sometimes called agency or agents. In other words, looking at translators in specific sets of circumstances. Now, people do this, if you like, in different ways. Some people do it from a sociological point of view. Somebody like Daniel Simioni, Moira Ingileri, would look at how translators, if you like, function within social systems as part of a social system in society in a kind of contemporary setting. Others, such as Professor Genalte, Jean de Lille, Anthony Pym, look at the translators, if you like, in a historical sense. How are translators in earlier historical periods, how have they acted as translators, what influence have they had, how have they been influenced by other cultures, political pressures, and so on. And in the area of teaching, we have somebody like Donald Kirley, who with his theory of social constructivism looks at the, if you like, student translator as a kind of an agent, someone who is influenced both by the social context in which he or she works and also certain social psychological elements. But it seems to me that one of the things that we tend to miss is the sense in which translators are not so much subjects as objects. In other words, so when we talk about agents or agency, we're talking about the translator as, you know, someone who is doing something, is carrying out the translation, or is doing the piece of interpreting. But one of the things that seems to me we could look at a lot more is the translator as an object. In other words, how translators are presented or represented in various media. Because one of the things that's very striking, for example, if you look at just the last decade, is the number of novels and books in which translators have been central or key characters. We've got Gosch, The Hungry Tide, 2004, the translator is a central figure. Javier Marias, The Corazón Tan Blanco, another book where an interpreter is a central figure. Eric Ossena, Le Zeté, 2003, the translator of Nabokov's Ada. Dan Brown's The Da Vinci Code translation turns up all over the place in that particular book. Matthew Pearl's The Dante Club. And the wonderful book by the Argentinian novelist Pablo de Santis, La Traducción, came out in 2000, where again and again and again in these books, translation and translators are center stage. So one of the questions that I want to ask is, why has this come about? Why should translators be objects of representation in novels, but more explicitly what I'm going to look at this afternoon is on the big screen. However, before I do this, I want to advance or develop an idea which will be quite central or key to what I'm going to be arguing this afternoon. It's often been said that in the Western tradition of thought, that people were, when people thought about thinking agents, somebody who was thinking about existence and being and the value of life and so on, that that person was very much seen as a kind of a disembodied agent. The person never fell sick, they never had brothers and sisters, they seemed to have no parents, they never went on holidays, they never seemed to eat, they never seemed to go to the toilet. These were sort of, you know, they were just sort of disembodied, free-floating, rational agents. And if you like, in a certain kind of tradition of Western rationalism, this was seen as the definitive thinking subject. Now, this in recent years has been challenged by a number of philosophers such as Alistair MacIntyre and Charles Taylor, who, drawing on earlier work by Wittgenstein and Heidegger, have argued that in fact the way in which we can properly understand the human agent as somebody that is embodied in particular situations. In other words, that the only way, or one of the only ways in which one can properly evaluate or understand the genesis of thought, where thought emerges, is to look at people as embodied creatures in particular sets of situations. And to give you an example of a concrete example of how this, what this means in terms of us thinking about translation, I want to refer to a passage in the novel by, well, I think the novel is more a sort of a narrative, by Primo Levi. Se questo è un uomo, if this is a man, his account of the period or the time that he spent in Auschwitz. What happens when the deportees are brought from Italy to the camp in Auschwitz? There's a point where there's various German officers coming in and out. And at one point, the German officer asks if there is an interpreter. And at this point, a man called Flesch, he presents himself, if you like, as an interpreter. And he then, if you like, begins to interpret for the German officer. And the way in which Primo Levi kind of describes the scene is he talks about the words in the mouth of this interpreter, Flesch. And he says it was his mouth was kind of writhing in disgust. He was like, it's almost like he's spitting out the words as if it was a foul drink in Bogone. Disgustoso, I think, is the word he kind of uses in the book itself. So what you see then is that here he is as an embodied, he has a body, And so therefore he can be subject to coercion or torture by the German officers. But he's also using his body to communicate. So his body is both communicating, but it's also expressing the particular situation in which he finds himself. So that at one level, his body is expressing its alimentary function. In fact, it can drink, it can take in nutrition or food. But it's also expressing its linguistic dimension. So, of course, the difficulty for flesh is that, and this is one of the differences, if you like, between interpreting and translation, is that the point of production and the point of reception in the case of interpreting are coterminous. What I mean by that is that you could produce a translation in Barcelona, and this translation could be very, very controversial, and be read in Dublin or London or Stockholm. The fact is that you as translator are producing it here in one city, you will not be there when the text is being read or reacted to in another place. The point of production is not happening at the same time as the point of reception. But in the case of interpreting, the point of production and the point of reception are the same. So therefore, the fact that you have a body, that you are an embodied agent, means that you can be subject to the pressures that come immediately from somebody reacting to or receiving the particular text that you are offering. So therefore, the translator as embodied agent is someone who is very, very sensitive, uniquely sensitive to the kind of the pressures of the context of his or her utterances. And for those of you who saw that wonderful film by Roberto Benigni, La Vita è Bella, you may remember that this scene, which is taken from Sequestro in Uomo, is in fact reproduced in the film, but he does it in a slightly different way. You have the the German officer who, in very stereotypical German ways, of barking orders to the unfortunate deportees. And then Roberto Benigni makes up this completely fantastic and lunatic translation of the German officer's orders. So, if you like, the Benigni figure, rather like the flesh figure in Sequestro in Uomo, is uniquely sensitive to the pressures of the context. What I want to consider now is the extract that we're going to have a look at, if technology works, is how embodied agency works in the case of Lost in Translation. And I'm going to say a little bit about another film called The Interpreter. One of the things that I want you to look at in this extract from Lost in Translation is the way in which emotions are expressed and the kind of relationship between the position of the interpreter, the director in the scene that we're going to see, whether emotion transcends language or whether it is in fact a prisoner of language. So just to, I'm sure quite a lot of you have seen the film, just to remind you, you know, it's two characters. There's the young woman who is there in Tokyo with her perfectly awful boyfriend who goes off taking photographs of starlets. So she finds herself in this kind of hotel room in Tokyo, this character Charlotte in her mid-20s. And then you've got Bill Harris, who is a kind of B-movie actor. You know, a thing that happens to a lot of people when they, you know, they're no longer in the limelight in Hollywood, they can make quite a good living doing you know, advertisements in other countries, in this case in Japan. So he's going through this midlife crisis. He's over in Tokyo. They want him to do an ad for a whiskey, Suntory whiskey. So hopefully this will.
Thank you.
Charlotte's behind, so if I can go back to the menu. Can you hear it? Is this, can you hear sound? Should be sound in a minute.
Relaxing times. Make it Suntory time.
Whose Japanese is not quite up to scratch, I'll just give you a very brief translation of what is said. At the beginning of that scene, you hear a kind of this whispering going on in the background. It's rather difficult to hear, but what they're saying is, we better get an interpreter. Please go and find an interpreter. And then the director, you know, says to the Bill Murray character, he says, you're sitting in the study, in front of you is Suntory whiskey on the table. Do you understand? And says, looking at the whiskey bottle, put emotion in slowly, gently, and looking at the camera and gently, as if meeting an old friend, you understand, like Bogey, like Humphrey Bogart, Suntory time. And then the interpreter says, he's ready now to go to shoot. So she's talking to the director and she says, he wants to know whether he's to look to the left or the right. And then the director says, who cares? It doesn't matter. I've no time to explain. I don't care. Get into emotion. Look at the camera and keep your eyes on the camera. Keep emotion high, put passion in. Do you understand with intensity? And then it goes on. This is a big long passage, and the Bill Murray says, you know, she just kind of translates, you know, one or two sentences. He says, was that all he said? But what he does say is, what you're saying is not only whiskey, but it's as if you're meeting an old friend, because whiskey is mature, like a mature relationship. So gently, from the bottom of your heart, as if something is coming up, maintain the passion. You love this whiskey, whiskey time. And then he sort of, you know, he says, start shooting. And then he stops again, and he says, cut, 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 cut. He says, you don't understand, do you? He says, you know, talking to Bill Murray, you look like a poker face. Do you understand? Hibiki is a very, very expensive whiskey here in Japan. It's the most expensive whiskey in the Suntory range. Why are you so low-key? Why don't you get more excited? You should be feeling a prestige in your voice. This is not just some ordinary drink. Express feeling of being in a prestigious situation or setting. And he says, prepare, and then the camera people start. And then when you see him at the end, you know, he starts, you know, he's shouting again. He says, stop, I'm begging you. You can't do this right. You don't understand, do you? You know, you're too stupid. So this is what, if you like, is happening in this. Now, the interesting thing in that situation is that for those of you who are not Japanese speakers in the audience, I would assume it would be the majority, you probably felt yourself a bit like in the Bill Murray situation. In other words, that, you know, somebody speaking a foreign language, you was a feeling of helplessness. It's the interpreter who's got the monopoly of that scarce resource, which is language, and you become as dependent on the interpreter as the Bill Murray character in the movie. What's interesting to me in this scene is to take out, if you like, extract three elements from it. One is that what we get in the scene is a complete reversal of stereotypical representations of Orientals in Western Anglophone cinema. In other words, the very common representation of Oriental characters in Westerns is the kind of the inscrutable Orientals, right? That it was impossible to read what they were thinking from their facial expressions. This is very much the kind of stereotypical image. But what we can find here is that the people who are, if you like, excitable and very, very expressive, you know, are the Japanese characters, whereas the people who are very kind of, you know, phlegmatic and inscrutable is the sort of the Western character, you know, Bill Murray's face, which, you know, shows a certain amount of emotion but remains to some extent inscrutable in this. So you could say at one level that what this is doing is feeding to a particular kind of stereotype, like, you know, funny foreigners running around the place waving their hands and doing strange things. But on another level, it is undermining a particular stereotypical representation of Orientals. The second thing, and this more centrally relates to translation, is the way in which, if you like, here, we have, on the one hand, the interpreter is the person who is exercising probably the greatest degree of self-control, because what she's trying to do is she's trying to mediate between the director, who is, you know, very, very emotionally worked up and highly charged, and then the Bill Murray character, who is very reserved and quite staid. So she's constantly, she's trying to manage or negotiate a difficult position, because she, of course, is an embodied agent. The point of reception and the point of production are happening at the exact same place and time in this particular studio. But what's interesting is that what creates the greatest difficulty in this scene is precisely communicating emotion. Remember the word that she keeps using, intensity, you know? Emotion, intensity. But it's trying to capture that particular emotion or intensity is the most difficult, and this brings me, if you like, onto the third point, because this is where, if you like, what we're trying to communicate is embedded in the culture. Bill Murray's fundamental problem is that he does not understand the cultural resonance or importance of Suntory whiskey and Hibiki as one of the whiskies in the Suntory range. In other words, something that's extremely prestigious in Japanese culture and becomes, you know, totally opaque to Bill Murray. So the kind of that notion of maturity, of prestige, etc. You know, and if you think of the importance in the globalized world of brands and the emotional resonance of particular brands, then you see how this relationship between cultural resonance, emotional resonance, and translatability becomes quite fundamental. Because what we get in this particular scene where they're doing this advertisement is almost like a vignette of the entire film. Because what's happening in this particular scene is we see an American in Japan who seems to be in a world that he can recognize to some extent. It's the world of advertising, cinema, TV production, these things that seem to be part of kind of a global technological culture. But very, very quickly, he runs into a kind of an opacity, into points of translation difficulty, which are to do with the culture in which he finds himself. And it's the translation or the interpreting scene which is the most effective way of highlighting the way in which, to some extent, one of the central problems in globalization is people wanting, if you like, the joys of connectivity without the pain of connectedness, the kind of labor that the translator or interpreter has to engage in. Another film which came out 2 years after Lost in Translation was The Interpreter. This didn't have the same kind of success as Lost in Translation, and probably for the very good reason is that it wasn't, the plot was extremely, it was quite complicated, and it wasn't a terribly credible film at various levels. But what kind of interests me is, again, the fact that you've got a major Hollywood film that has an interpreter as the central character. The Nicole Kidman character, she plays the role of a woman called Sylvia Broom, who one night working she goes back to collect her belongings in the UN, and she overhears in her headset somebody having a conversation where she claims they're plotting to kill the prime minister or the leader of a country called Mobutu, which seems to be loosely based on Zimbabwe. So a man called Edmund Mwane, who is the leader of Mobutu, so she then goes and tells the UN security people about this plot. Now what then happens is, and of course almost inevitably, is that she becomes an object of suspicion. Right? The FBI want to know why is she making this complaint? It's the way in which very often, in any kind of detective novel, they would tell you that it's often the person who reports the crime who is in fact the main culprit. And this is why, as we can see time and time again, when these FBI want to find out who is this Sylvia Broom, so they check with UN security, and they're told that she's born in the United States, she grew up in Africa, she has a British mother, she's a white African father, she studied music in Johannesburg, she studied linguistics in Sorbonne, and if that wasn't enough, she went off and learned several languages in different European countries. It's a bit exhausting. You probably feel you have a long way to go before you become a qualified interpreter for the UN. But what's interesting is the head of security in the UN says she is the UN. In other words, Sylvia Broom is the quintessential embodiment of the UN with its diversity of cultures, languages, and so on. But then something happens, which, if like, is interesting from our point of view, is that ultimately, it does emerge that she is involved in, or she has been involved in, military resistance to the Mwane regime, that she's not quite as neutral as she claims. And so the FBI and CIA, et cetera, get more and more interested in her. But the question that the detective, Sean Penn, he asks is, who is she? He says, you know, I want to know more about this woman. And then at one point she goes missing. And when his kind of colleagues then try and find out who she is, they keep coming back and say, nobody seems to know this woman. That she seems to be kind of sort of an inscrutable figure, that nobody seems to have a really detailed good knowledge or acquaintance with her. But what's interesting, if you think about it for a moment, this is a woman who is multilingual, who has lived in different places, although she is, if you like, somebody who's a European parent, she's very insistent on the fact that she is African, very proud of her African identity, white African identity, that she is someone, if you like, who is, the reason that, if you like, people say that she's difficult to know or who is she, is that she upsets conventional expectations. She can't be put into one particular box, you know, as a woman behaving in a particular way, or as a white, you know, a daughter of white European center behaving in a specific way, or linguistically sticking to one language and one place. She's somebody that sort of moves around between all these different things. And we could say, of course, that this is characteristic of every single person in this room. There's not one person in this room who is monolingual. I would hazard a guess the majority of people in this room have spent periods of time elsewhere, have family connections with other parts of Europe and the world. In other words, that, and this, of course, is the default condition of humanity. The majority of human beings on the planet speak more than one language, have different cultural allegiances. And what, in fact, the character of Sylvia Broome is suggesting, and this is, you know, as a kind of representation of an interpreter, is that the person of the translator or the interpreter is in some ways not so much an exceptional being. They are, of course, exceptional because they have these great linguistic gifts, but they are unexceptional insofar as that most beings on the planet have kind of composite identities, both linguistic and cultural, and that what the translators and interpreters bring to fore, make explicit, is what is implicit or latent for many people in our global age. One of the things that happens very early on in the film, when Sylvia Broome is being interrogated by the FBI agent, he wants to know, what does she actually think of this guy, Zuani? And he says to her, he says, would you prefer if he was gone, right? And that's the word that he uses. And she says, yes, I would prefer it if he was gone. And then he says, you mean dead? And then she says, dead and gone are not the same thing. And she goes on to say, if I interpreted dead as gone at the UN, I would be out of my job tomorrow morning. And Keller's the name of the police detective, says, stop playing around with words. That's just kind of word play. And she says, words and compassion are the better way, even if slower than the gun. So words and compassion are the better way, even if slower than the gun. For example, a little later on in the film, she meets somebody who is the leader of the armed resistance to Mwane's regime in Bamboto. And he says, what are you doing now? And she says, oh, I'm working as an interpreter. And he says, oh, the United Nations, layers of languages signifying nothing. So he thinks, like the police detective, this is all just words. But one of the things that, if you like, one of the kind of personal tragedies in her life, and this is the scene which opens the film, her brother gets killed, gets assassinated, is her brother is compiling lists of names of people who have been killed by the Mobutu regime. When they were children, they used to compile lists of exotic and interesting words. As adults, what the brother is doing is he's compiling the lists of all the victims of the regime. One of the things that he's doing is he's breaking a taboo in the Mobutan culture, which is you should not name the dead. It's the same in Irish Gaelic culture. It was considered to be bad luck to mention the name of the dead person. But what he's doing is he's breaking this taboo and he's naming the dead. But what Broom is suggesting to Keller, what she suggests to the leader of the armed resistance, and what her brother is doing before he's killed, is suggesting that words and language are important. Terminological accuracy is important. Dead and gone are not the same thing. And she says at one point that if we don't take care of language, language will take care of us. In other words, we will become victims of a language that will be used in an exploitative and coercive way by others. So in a way, you can see that what she, as interpreter, is in this film, she's suddenly this handling language. At the end, she does resort to a gun. In her early life, she did, but she's talked out of the use of the gun. So words, if you like, ultimately carry greater weight. So what the figure of the interpreter or the translator is suggesting is that language is the essential precondition and context of compassion. And of course, I suppose it goes without saying that this is happening, or this film has been made against the backdrop of what was happening in Iraq. There are many, many other examples in recent cinema of translators and interpreters. For those of you who've seen the Steven Spielberg film, Munich, when it looks at the assassination of the Israeli athletes in Munich in 1972, and then the Mossad squad go to hunt down the people who are escaped, or a part of the assassins. But what's interesting is the very first of the two people that we get to meet who are assassinated by the Mossad squad, the first person is becomes the Italian translator of 1001 Nights. He's the translator of the Arabian Nights. The second person who is assassinated is the person who works as the interpreter for the PLO militants when they finally go to, I think it's Tunisia, after they escape. So again and again and again, we get the figure of the translator or the interpreter who are offered to us, if you like, as central figures in these films. What I'd like to do in the final section of my lecture this afternoon is to advance four reasons for why I think not only is this so now, but why it's going to continue into the future, and why it's very, very important, it seems to me, that when we study translation and interpreting, we look not just as translations as agents, as subjects, but as objects of representation. The first, it seems to me, relates to this concept which, you know, is we use a great deal these times, which is that of globalization. One of the greatest difficulties that's presented by globalization is the problem of identification and the problem of empathy. In other words, if we talk about globalizing forces, whether they be political, whether they be financial, whether they be military, if you're talking about something happening at the level of the globe, happening internationally, the more extended these systems are, the more abstract they become, the more difficult it becomes to actually get any proper understanding or feeling for what these globalizing forces are. And this is where the translator and the interpreter are so crucial in Hollywoodian, and I would argue fictive, strategies of representation, because what they do is they allow one to see how global forces, be they military, be they financial, be they cultural, operate through the agency of one particular individual. In other words, by seeing a scene there like Lost in Translation, seeing, you know, sort of a concrete embodiment of a cultural difficulty and attempts at cultural exchange, it allows one to have a much more direct experience or an attempt to understand what is happening with respect to more abstract systems. So, if you like, what is true for narrative, a kind of basic principle, that it's easier for a reader to identify with specific individual characters, is also true in attempts to, if you like, understand greater abstractions as they relate to globalizing systems of one kind or the other. The second is to do with what I would call dual valency. And what I mean by dual valency is the notion that one of the great difficulties in all translation exchange, and indeed in cultural exchange, is on the one hand, we often think of emotions as transcending language barriers. For example, when we, even though we might understand Japanese, we see that we seem to sense that the director is very bothered, is very annoyed, is very troubled by you know what the actor is doing. So we kind of feel that there's almost sort of a universal emotional language. It's one of the reasons, for example, why when people are trying to communicate with someone in another language and we don't quite understand what they're saying, we don't understand the other language, look at what people do. Unfortunately, in the Anglophone world, we just tend to sort of start shouting at people, to kind of raise our voice. And the idea being that if you shout louder, you're going to be... there's actually a good reason, though, for that, is when you shout, you speak more slowly and you articulate better. So there is a certain kind of reason. But taking that apart, the other thing you'll notice is that people grin. You know, they've a great sort of grin. The idea being that situations of non-communication, if you think of all the science fiction movies you've ever seen, when people come down and speak strange languages, it's usually a sign that you're in trouble. The next thing they're going to start producing ray guns, or you're going to disappear or be. So the notion of smiling is to if you like, say, you know, I come in goodwill, you know, I mean you goodwill, I might understand what you're saying, or I might have difficulty communicating, but I mean well. But that's, so what we're doing there is we're supposing that there's a kind of universal language of emotion. But one of the things that's most difficult, this is what Sylvia Broom finds in The Interpreter, this is what our young Japanese interpreter finds here in Lost in Translation, is that the most difficult thing of all to communicate is emotion. And it's often because of emotional misunderstandings that we get tragic consequences. Like Sylvia Broom at one stage says, you know, when she's talking about it, she meets a man called Lils Lud, who is the head of the security services of Moane. Moane is coming to the UN to speak. This is why this assassination attempt. And he says, why did you leave Africa to go to the UN? And she says, well, I wanted to do a bit of quiet diplomacy. And he says, but with respect, you're only an interpreter. And she says, but countries have gone to war with each other because they've often misinterpreted what each other said. In fact, some people say that was one of the reasons for the outbreak of the First World War was the misinterpretation of the telegram. Another from Japanese translation history, one of the arguments is the atom bomb might not have been dropped if a particular word had been translated appropriately from Japanese into English and vice versa. So there is a certain element of truth in that historically, but more importantly, it's what she's suggesting is that in translation, we have both emotion that seems to go beyond language, but yet one of the things that translators have the most difficulty dealing with is precisely that thing that will not go beyond language, which is emotion. The third element is what I would call triangulation. Triangulation is the one of the things that's happening, unfortunately, in contemporary politics is a tendency to set up polarities in the world between what's called the jihad versus Mac world, or Samuel Huntington talks about the great clash of civilizations. So you've got, you know, Islam on one side, some notion of the Christian West on the other. Sometimes it's the Asian world that's held up as a threat, etc. So there's all these kind of polarities. What the English critic Gillian Rose has suggested is that when you get two opposites, right, two polarities, if they head to each other, they would, of course, there would be impact and there would be an explosion. Okay? The only way to avoid impact between two polarities is to triangulate, right? To have something that's going to prevent the two from having a head-on collision. And this is the work of triangulation. Triangulation is diplomacy, triangulation is cultural mediation, but triangulation is also translation. So one of the things, in an odd way, or an interesting way, that certain kinds of Hollywood, and I'm not talking about art house, but mainstream cinema is trying to suggest, is to look at the possibilities, the necessary possibility of triangulation in a world of dangerous bipolarity. And finally, and this is perhaps to finish up on a rather kind of ambitious point, but it's to do with the fact that one of the reasons it seems to me that the translator as an embodied agent is central as an object of representation in contemporary cinema is the shift from epistemology to ontology. What I mean by that is that it's, whereas before you would make films about, you know, other places to show you what other cultures were like, what it was like to go around the city of Paris or Amsterdam or Barcelona or whatever. So you're getting to know other places and other cultures. So this would be epistemological. Increasingly, it seems to me, what's happening with the translator and interpreter is we're having an ontological perspective. In other words, that what it's like to be a particular person in a specific place at a specific time. And that one of the things in trying to, if you like, move towards a better world for people to live in, a better place for people to live in, is to recognize the fact that the vast majority of people on the planet do not move. 85% of the world's population do not travel outside 27 kilometers of the place in which they were born. This is despite all our talk about movement and migration. So people are affected in their daily lives in the specific places in which they live. They enjoy things, they suffer, and they die. And that by, if you like, making the ontological perspective central, making the figure of the translator or the interpreter somebody who is embodied, we get a much more accurate and a much better vision of what it is like to be a human being in our global age. So many thanks for listening to me this afternoon, and I hope very much, I have been doing some work on the Star Wars trilogies, and I hope you haven't felt that you spend too much time listening to the dark side of the Force, and that ultimately the good side will win out. Thank you.
Merci, professeur Cronin, pour cette émouvante leçon inaugurale qui pour moi a été une belle apologie de la traduction et de l'interprétation. Bé, plau, per, si em deixeu dir-vos alguns mots per acabar aquest acte i per cloure aquest acte en nom del rector i de la universitat, i assenyalar breument alguns objectius de la universitat pel que fa a la recerca i pel que fa a la docència, en el qual la vostra facultat també hi està implicada i participa. Sabeu doncs, que tenim en aquests moments, pel que fa a la recerca, tres objectius clarament definits, que són la recerca que es fa en el Parc de Recerca Biomèdica, com a gran centre de biomedicina, el que es farà també a la Cala Aranyó, en el districte 22 arroba, sobre la recerca en comunicació i en les noves tecnologies de la informació, i també el nou centre de recerca en humanitats i ciències socials, en els quals jo crec que la vostra facultat també hi té molt a dir. I pel que fa a la docència, recordar doncs, que estem en plena reforma, ja ho ha dit el degà en el seu discurs anteriorment, d'apostar per l'Espai Europeu d'Ensenyament Superior i, per tant, atès que ha desaparegut els catàlegs de titulacions, ens toca ara, en aquests moments, procedir a la reforma dels plans d'estudi i confegir amb tota llibertat i autonomia, però també amb tota responsabilitat, el nou pla d'estudis que, com ha assenyalat el degà, doncs ja ha començat a endegar a funcionar a través de la corresponent comissió. També en aquest sentit doncs, tenim el gran interès en que els graus siguin seguits d'un postgrau que el qual ja ha començat, encara que paradoxalment ha començat abans el postgrau que el grau, però en el qual doncs, la mobilitat dels estudiants sigui un referent i també la internacionalitat, i aquí també vosaltres doncs, heu sigut pioners en aquest punt, no? La importància de conèixer altres cultures, altres llengües, altres països, tant pel que fa a anar d'aquí cap allà com els d'allà venir cap aquí i conèixer-nos a nosaltres. També permeteu-me recordar que un altre dels objectius que té aquest rectorat és el del multilingüisme. Apostar per una política de multilingüisme a fi de que es vagi avançant mica en mica i que sigui possible que la Universitat Pompeu Fabra, dintre de poc temps, tothom pugui utilitzar almenys tres llengües, si no més, i no solament doncs, tal. I ja per acabar, si em permeteu doncs, parafrasejar Pau en la seva epístola als Corints, que assenyalava que l'esperit era un, però que els dons eren diversos pel bé de tots. I entre aquests dons, que hi havia el de la paraula profunda o el de saber desglossar la veritat, també hi afegia el do de coneixement de les llengües misterioses i de la seva interpretació. Bé, vosaltres, com a facultat, teniu aquest do, teniu aquesta facultat doncs, de la traducció i de la interpretació. I jo us desitjo ara doncs, que, pel bé de tota la universitat, aquest curs 2007 i 2008 de la Facultat d'Interpretació i Traducció de la UPF, que declaro inaugurat, sigui ben fecund i molt satisfactori per tots vosaltres. Moltes gràcies. S'aixeca la sessió.